The Arnold Clark Real Sale is now on.
Welcome to Peter and Ruffy's Football Show and this one-to-one special with former Celtic striker Simon Donnelly. Delighted to have Simon with us here in the studio. A chance to look back at a career that, how do you view it? Is it one that didn't quite live up to your expectation, or one that you look at the glass and think it's half full?
I would say half full. I think looking back at seven seasons at Glasgow Celtic, went down to Sheffield Wednesday, came back to play with St Johnstone, Dunfermline, Partick. Fortunate enough to stay fit until I was 34, 35. So, yeah, successful for me.
Yeah, when you look back and it all kicks off, how did that move to Celtic come about?
I was at Queen's Park. I'd went along with a mate. I hadn't really been playing organised football, school football. Went along to Queen's Park for 6 months. Obviously did reasonably well, not enough to get Eddie Hunter to put me in the first team. Played with the Hams, played with the reserves, and Celtic came along and asked me to go to a tournament in Geneva in the summer of 92. Went along and played a couple of games at Celtic up at Helenville, the old Helenville. Did reasonably well, didn't do particularly well in the tournament in Geneva, but I think it was the games before I actually went that kind of caught the eye and signed for Celtic in June 92.
Yeah, I suppose not too many managers have to sell you the club, but was there something specific that maybe Liam Brady said to you that won you over?
Aye, me and my dad went along. My dad was more in awe of Liam Brady. I obviously knew of him, but my dad had obviously seen him play with Arsenal. We went along to negotiate the lucrative deal. I just wanted to play football, Peter, and you know, Glasgow Celtic came along, gave me the opportunity, and I couldn't knock it back.
Yeah, and from that point of view, I mean, this was a Celtic side going through a major upheaval. There was a lot of problems at the club at that time. I mean, if it wasn't managers going in and out the door, you know, players were in a revolving door as well. Did you sense that when you got into the club?
I didn't, to be honest, because I was 17. I was just delighted to be there. I didn't expect to hit the first team as quickly. I think I made my debut at 19. We'd already lost Liam Brady. Lou McCarry had come in and he gave me my debut, and I remember Lou not being particularly liked by the kind of senior players in the dressing room at the time, but me as a youngster I overlooked that. I just wanted to play football, and he gave me the chance to play in the first team towards the tail end of, I think it was the 93-94 season.
Yeah, and I think the one element of looking back at the managers you've played under, the one that followed, I mean, from everybody's point of view, is a guy who holds a special place in Celtic's history. I'm talking, of course, about Tommy Burns.
Aye, I think he holds a special place for guys of my kind of stature, the young guys that were coming through at the time. He was excellent for me. I'd always regarded myself as a striker, playing up front, and it was him that identified something in me or seen something in me that thought, I'll pull him back, play him in a deeper role, you know, and build the play. Take the kind of pressure off, you know, being the focal point as the main striker, and put me on the right side of midfield. And it was actually, I wouldn't say it was the making of me, but it actually developed. Obviously, Jackie came in on the back of that, and we had developed a great partnership up the right side of the park. But yeah, it probably brought the best out in my game, you know, in terms of trying to receive it from the defence and build it through to the attack force.
Yeah, and the one thing that, you know, many a manager, many a player has discussed about football, it can be sometimes overcomplicated when really it's a simple game. I thought that was one of Tam's great qualities. He had the ability to be a great man manager as well. Is that something that you found with him? Of course, he was a great wind-up merchant too.
Aye, I mean, he was a father figure to the young guys. You know, he took 3 or 4 hours back regularly in afternoons, worked on little things, but it was all simple. As you say, for me, football's a simple game as well. But there was just little bits that would, little pointers that would help you on a Saturday. Even down to just passing drills, you know, he would demand everything off you. If it was a yard out, you know, he'd come on, boy, get it right. And you didn't want to let him down. It made you challenge yourself. It made you, you know, demand from yourself. Even if it was a passing drill, a possession drill, He also played in the reserves with Starkey, and they were coming to the end of their career. So, you know, if you played that maybe a yard too much and he couldn't get there, it'd be your fault rather than his age catching up with him.
Yeah. Did you get the sense, like so many of the fans, that they were willing him to win something? They wanted him to succeed?
Again, because of the youth side of it, I was just kind of taking everything in my stride at the time. I think when we won the Cup in 95, I think you could see the relief in Paul McStay's face, Peter Grant's face, guys that had been around the club, guys that had won things at the club. And obviously in this barren spell, a lot of pressure was on them. The Hart was the skipper of the club at the time. And they also had a relationship with Tommy and Billy. They were ex-teammates and wanted to do well. It was only when we kind of won it there that you kind of realised that, and the monkey was off the back. The big regret for me is the 95-96 season, or just round about that era when we had a really good team. We only get beat once, we had too many draws. I think that team, the football we played, deserved, you know, a title. It deserved Tommy Burns to win a title for Celtic.
Yeah, isn't it amazing that you're talking about a side that only lost one game, but Celtic fans still hold that side in high regard because of the nature of the way you played the game?
Aye, and it's a huge compliment. I mean, I get as many fans coming up to me and talking about that season as the stopping the 10, 98 season, which is remarkable because we didn't win it. But I think just the nature of the football, you know, it's an entertainment business. The punters were getting entertained. They were coming and watching us playing good football. For me as a player on the team, it was an absolute joy to play with these players. We brought in Pierre from Holland, who was a real catalyst in the way we went on to play. All the young boys learned off him. And it was the Celtic way, as they talk about. Tommy Burns wanted that kind of free-flowing attacking football, and we provided it. Unfortunately for us, we were against a really good Rangers team at the time, and made too many draws.
Yeah, you mentioned you were a young player then, but were there players that you actually looked at and thought, oh, this is a dream to play with?
McStay was the best for me. Charlie Nicholas, I came in and made my debut up front with Charlie Nicholas. He was coming to the end of his career, but Charlie could make space for himself just by moving a yard, moving a defender a yard, the intelligence of him. You were learning off these guys day in, day out. Van Hooijdonk, when he came, brought a different element to it. You know, he'd be the first guy to stay behind after training practice, say free kicks, which he was an expert at. And I always compare him to the likes of Cantona's effect with the young boys at Man United. He had that effect with us. You know, if it was good enough for him to come back in practice, it was good enough for us. And he lifted our game to another level.
Yeah. Was the Holy Grail winning a championship with Celtic?
It was for me in the end, yeah. Yeah, because as I say, we were up against a really good Rangers team throughout that nine in a row era. Unfortunately enough, we stopped it in 98. But yeah, it would have been a huge regret if I'd left Celtic without winning a league.
Yeah, what was so special about that season then? Because a lot of people say the pressure must have been unbelievable. You talked about the fact that you've broken into a side, you're young, you just want to play. Slowly but surely, you start to become a mainstay in a side which is, you know, get fans on their back non-stop, get this, stop the 10 in a row.
Again, it's something that I look back on now. You know, if I'd played at 30 plus, I think I wouldn't have been able to handle the nerves as much. I think at the time, 23, 24, I think I only really felt it the penultimate weekend at Dunfermline when we should have won it.
Yeah.
And then it goes back the next week to St Johnston. We're 1-0 up, and I remember knowing for a fact Rangers were winning. And St Johnston had a couple of skirmishes in our box at 1-0, which it could all went horribly wrong for us. And then I got substituted for Harold, and it was only that last little period of the season where you effectively become a supporter. That was the most nervous I was, because when you're on the pitch, you can influence it and you're focused on your job. When you're in the dugout, you just become a fan, and it was relief in the end when we got the second goal.
Yeah, in the next part of the programme, we'll discuss the move away from Celtic and the teams that you played for, and of course, your international career as well. But was there a point in your mind where you thought, and you know, I've served my time, I've got to move on, or did you think I should have stayed?
I think looking back at it now, I think in terms of I've went on record as saying that I never played in a dressing room with as much quality as I had at Celtic. When I left there even to go to Sheffield Wednesday, no disrespect to the guys at Sheffield Wednesday in a Premiership dressing room, they weren't of the same quality as I'd just left. So from that point of view, regret not playing with that level of player again. But at the time, you're 24, I'd been there 7 years, the Goldfish Bowl of Glasgow. Being a particularly shy guy at the time, you know, it was a decision that I made to go to the Premiership in England that I have to stand by. You know, I had four good years there, experience in life, but the football was never the same as when I was at Celtic.
Yeah. Did it make it easier that you went there with Phil O'Donnell?
It did, aye. It did, because we went down, we were going through the same thing. Even the pre-contract stuff, we got a bit of grief. We were going through that together. We went down there with the families. He had a young family at the time. I went with my girlfriend at the time. And we did. We helped each other along. We had some injury problems there. He had more than myself. But we helped ourselves through it and settling in. It was a settling process, you know, the fact that you'd a familiar person in the dressing room.
And isn't it amazing that when you look back, people automatically don't think Simon Donnelly, Sheffield Wednesday, Partick, Dunfermline. They just look and think Simon Donnelly, Celtic.
It's the nature of the beast, isn't it? It's Glasgow Celtic, the size of it. But, I mean, I was proud to play with other clubs. You know, I enjoyed playing with all the clubs that I was lucky enough to play with over my career. But, yeah, it's the nature of it. You know, everybody attaches you to Celtic.
Yeah, absolutely. Lots of great memories. You mentioned the hat. Anybody else stick in your mind?
In terms of quality?
Yeah. I can't believe you haven't mentioned Larson.
Henrik, obviously, yeah. Henrik is, well, Henrik's the best I've played with. Yeah. You know, Paul McStay coming through was an education for me. I came from playing with the 18s in the reserves into I remember actually getting flung in there maybe 2 or 3 days before I made my debut, and the level goes up, and you either sink or swim, but you're playing with guys in there like McStay, Collins, that I just fed off.
Yeah.
But obviously when I established myself in the team and Henrik comes along, I mean, he was just a joy to play with.
Tam Burns pushed you back into the midfield in a strange sort of way. Did that help you in your later career, or did you sometimes switch back to being the out-and-out striker?
Yeah, I switched back, but it definitely helped me because you see the game from a different perspective. And I like to play off the front as well, you know, with a centre-forward, you know, playing round about. The kind of number 10 roles they call nowadays, but I don't go in for that stuff. But it just gave you a different perspective of how to play the game. I think he's seen something in my game that he realised I wasn't a predator as a number 9. You know, there was more to my game. You know, I like to build up, I like to create. I get actually much of a buzz off an assist as I did as scoring a goal. So I think he's seen that in my game and hence put me a wee bit deeper.
Yeah. Tell me about Sheffield Wednesday.
Sheffield Wednesday was a difficult one. You know, me and Phil had signed a pre-contract months before we went down, which was another weird experience for me because we took a bit of stick off some of the Celtic support, which I didn't anticipate. You're 24, you've decided, you've made your mind up for a change, going down to the English Premiership. I think your first two games were Liverpool and Man U, so that kind of justified my move at the time. Unfortunately, that first season I had a bad injury and I missed the best part of probably a season on the back of it, which gave me this kind of tag of being injury prone, which yeah. I didn't really go along with. It was my first serious injury that I'd had, but unfortunately the timing of it was horrendous. You're at a new club, you're trying to make a good impression, and I couldn't do that. And that tied in with us obviously getting relegated as well. So my period there, I mean, I've got a lot of good memories and some good times. I scored in the FA Cup penalty to take us through against Wolves. There's little things that I can take from it. My first son was born in Sheffield. I've got a lot of good friends from there. But the football could have been better for me.
Yeah, if you think you're getting flack from Celtic fans for moving, you'll get a fair bit of flack if he ends up playing for England. You know that, don't you?
I know that. I know. I wind him up regularly because his other two brothers were born in Scotland, so he's the Englishman in the family.
Yeah. Was it a great sense of disappointment when you had to leave Sheffield? I mean, it is a huge footballing city as well, but yeah. You must have got to that point you thought, got to go, it's just not happening here.
Well, it was in conjunction with my first boy being born in 2003, and it was a decision that I had to make. You know, my wife wanted to come back up to Scotland with a network of family here that was a lot easier to deal with our kid coming along. But the football, I enjoyed the time there, I really did, and if I'd possibly get another move there, you know, I might have still be down south, you know, the way things pan out in football. But thankfully for me, I get the opportunity to come back up the road with Starkey at St Johnson.
Yeah, was it Billy Stark that was the influence and the driving force behind it? Because yeah. From a boy who plays in Glasgow to go to Sheffield and then suddenly think Perth is, you know, a wee bit of a change for you.
It was, aye, but it was purely for Starkey because yeah. I'd worked with him at Celtic and had a good relationship with him and Tommy. And he phoned me up and asked me if I'd be interested in coming back up and try to rebuild my career, as you like. I was 27 at the time. well-documented stop-start time down at Sheffield for whatever reason, and it was an opportunity to get back playing football on a regular basis in a relatively successful season. Ultimately, we wanted to win the league and get back into the Premiership. But for me, on a personal note, I played more or less every game of the season, which was a big thing for me because, as I said, I had this kind of label of injury prone on the back of one kind of serious injury at Sheffield.
Well, see, with that serious injury, did it change you as a player? I mean, sometimes players get an injury which means they're never the same again. What did you feel, as if you'd lost a bit, or did you just feel it's something I can put to the back and try and re-establish myself?
To be honest, I never regarded myself as being quick anyway. Yeah. You know, I think the most important thing for me was the brain. You could think quicker than the person you were up against. You'll vouch for the 60s, Peter. But no, in all seriousness, I never had that luxury of pace. So I don't think it hindered me that way. You know, I was experienced enough just through my time in football to adapt to it. And as I say, the main thing for me was getting a run of games, and Starkey gave me that opportunity at St Johnson.
Yeah. Dunfermline, again, another football mad town. How did that move come about?
Again, there was another Celtic link with Davy Hay. Davy Hay was the manager at the time, and I'd had a reasonably good season at St Johnston, and on the back of that, they wanted to take me to the Premiership. I would have much preferred to come back into the Premiership with a winning team under Starkey. That wasn't to be, and he actually moved on. So that was another big influence on me, wanting to part ways with St Johnston at the time. And Davy gave me the chance to go to Dunfermline back in the Premiership.
Yeah. At that time as well, the one thing I would say to you is the football, we weren't quite into a period where, you know, clubs were cash-strapped. So there was a lot of good players in the divisions.
There was, yeah. There was some really good players. That, you know, the young brothers were at Dunfermline, Scott Wilson, Scott Thompson, good senior pros. And they'd actually, under Jimmy Calderwood, just before that, had a really successful period in Dunfermline. So I enjoyed my time there as well. Important for me just to get back playing. And as you say, after a serious injury, I think players appreciate it more. Just being out in the training ground. There's no better feeling out training, preparing for a game on a Saturday, knowing that you're fit. Because although my time at Sheffield and little things were directed at me and Phil in terms of, you know, being happy to sit there and pick her cash up, no player, if you ask them, wants to be in a gymnasium on bikes and treadmills day in, day out. It's soul-destroying. You want to be out playing football.
Yeah. And, of course, if you are going to come back to Glasgow, if it's not going to be Celtic, was it always going to be Partick Thistle?
The Harry Rags. Again, I was on holiday, and it was Dick Campbell, who was a bit of a character. He knew Jackie, and he got my number through Jackie and asked me to come in. Would I like to sign for them? They'd just been promoted from, it's League One now, back into the Championship, and I said yes, and actually went on to, I think it was only Celtic that I made more appearances for. I think I made over 100 appearances for Partick. So I look back my time there fondly, played with some good players, and it also gave me the opportunity to get into the coaching side when Jackie came to the club.
Yeah. Is there a game that stands out in your memory that you think, when I look back at my career, that one is the most special? And I can't steer you towards one club or the other.
I think making my debut for Celtic obviously sticks in my mind. My first goal for Celtic, I was fortunate enough to start one midweek against Raith Rovers, scored two goals, and you know, it was Roy the Rovers stuff for me. You thought, this is easy. Obviously, I found out as we went on, it wasn't as easy as that. But they games and Old Firm and European nights were special. Always wanted to play Rangers, particularly Ibrox, like getting into the Lions then. I made my debut there with the game with no Celtic support, and it was a fantastic feeling. People said, well, you know, nervous, but actually just kind of 19-year-old, you take it in your stride, you want to go in there, you know there's only the Celtic guys who are working there, or the Celtic men, everything else is blue.
Yeah.
We should have got the win. Mikhailichenko scored a lucky deflection to equalise. So that sticks in my mind in the European nights. Liverpool at Celtic Park was a great occasion.
Yeah, and although you managed to get, I think it was 10 caps for Scotland, was it a feeling of you should have played more, or was it a feeling you should have got more caps?
I think there's a wee bit of regret there. I think it tied in when we went to Sheffield Wednesday when I was on the 10 caps, and then the injury came in, and for whatever reason, I couldn't get back. You know, I think Volks came in at that time. There was a big change with the Scottish setup, And even when I came back, I remember Starkey saying that St Johnstone come back at 27, kick on, you might be considered again, but for whatever reason it never happened. But I still look back and say, well, you know, I got 10 caps, a lot of people didn't. I went to the World Cup, another regret, Bruni never gave me minutes on the park. I remember the Morocco game, I'm just warming up there saying, give me 5 minutes, give me 5 minutes so I can say I've played that World Cup. And he put Scott Booth on, and that was the final sub. But my whole experience of that was amazing. We went to America before it. We were there for the month. You're training in the morning, excuse me, you've got fantastic facilities. We were going to watch games. We opened it with Brazil, with the Kilts. So it's great memories. And on the back of his winning the league that year, I think there was 8 Celtic players in the squad as well. So it was familiarity and just a great experience for us.
Yeah, and when your family look back over all this, is it with tremendous pride as well? I mean, getting to the World Cup alone must be something that fills them with pride. But when you look back at all the clubs that you played for.
Aye, it's only now when I've got my son and I go and watch him playing his boys' club stuff and how I feel with that. I think, how did my family feel, you know, when I went to represent the country at the World Cup and they all came. It was great times for them. They all came and supported me wherever I went. So I do look back in that with a bit of pride. And hopefully my boys can follow in my footsteps.
And is it fair to say over the whole period of your career is, would the best football you've played been under Tommy Burns?
Aye, in a weird way, because I liked Vim. They were my two favourite coaches that I worked under, and Vim won the important one. And he brought Henrik in for $650,000, which is incredible. But the football, under Tommy, because I came into a Celtic team who were struggling. We were fourth or fifth in the league, which is, you can't quite get that round your head. But we were struggling, and for whatever reason, I got a chance. But when he came into the club again as manager, he rebuilt it. He brought flair back to the club. And it was, as I said earlier on in the interview, it was a Celtic way of playing, you know, free-flowing football, which suited my style. And it was a joy to be in that team.
Yeah. Do you still look at that medal every now and then?
My dad's got the medals. Yeah. My dad's got the medals, so he can hold on to them until they're passed down. But no, I'm just talking about earlier on, James Forrest. I've looked at his hall recently, and these guys have got a fantastic hodge of medals and collection there. I'm just grateful that I've got one each, you know, and I look back at them with a great sense of pride.
Yeah, well, listen, it's been an absolute joy talking to you. I could probably talk to you for another hour about your career, but there's many a footballer would be absolutely happy with your medal haul. They'll never get near it, or even wearing a Scotland jersey. My thanks to Simon Donnelly for sharing some of his football playing memories with us. Look out for some more football specials. But from Simon and myself, Peter Martin, thanks for watching. Good night.
The Arnold Clark Real Sale is now on.